I would like to first thank people who did this work. So bear with me. So I'm using a PDF now to basically show you what I want to show. So this student and postdoc here in yellow that you see marked here in yellow, they have been very instrumental in the part of the work that I'm going to show you. As Dr. Shukla actually mentioned, my group also work in the area of magnetism, superconductors, and hard materials. And the materials we are basically interested in mostly contain the element boron, right? So I will introduce the field of boron-based material to you and hydrogen, which is the main application we want to target. How do we use boron-based materials to produce hydrogen that we can use as an energy source? So in this outline here, I'll walk you through some of the compounds that we have developed and studied in terms of their electrocatalysis properties. So with some time at the end, if you have, typically you'll be very tight, I'll be talking about some nanomaterials. So basically, we've been working on something completely different to what the catalysis community usually do. We've been using bulk materials. So bulk materials are very large in particle size compared to nanomaterials. Yet we find that they are extremely active. Now, why are we interested in hydrogen? So hydrogen is being considered right now in many applications, including, as you can see here, in electric vehicles, as energy storage. And the main advantage of hydrogen is that hydrogen compared to carbon-based fuels can be actually prepared directly from water instead of using carbon-based sources. So, and because of that, hydrogen is a relatively clean energy. Now, if you use hydrogen in cars, the main advantage also there is that you will have water as a product of the combustion of the hydrogen. Right? And that means it is non-toxic for the environment. But hydrogen has a lot of challenges. And the main challenge that I want to address today is how do you produce hydrogen efficiently? And in particular, in yellow mark here, currently hydrogen is being produced using fossil fuels. And because you are using fossil fuels, first of all, it's not good for the environment. So we need to use another source, which is water. Now, starting with water, we basically do a process called water splitting. We take water molecules and rip them apart and get hydrogen on one side and oxygen on another side. Now, that process is relatively difficult. And because of that, we need catalysts. So currently, even for hydrocarbons that are used in industry currently to produce hydrogen, the catalyst that's been used is platinum. Now, when we talk about water splitting, when you want to split water, we use this process called electrolysis. Basically, we have in this device here, we have water, and typically the water will be basically acidified to produce a lot of protons, as you can see H plus there. And on the cathode here, on the cathode, we will coat the cathode with our catalyst. In this case, it's platinum. And on the anode, we coat it with another catalyst, which help produce oxygen, right? Or split water on that side to produce oxygen. So on the cathode, we produce hydrogen. On the anode, we produce oxygen. Now, let me walk you through the type of materials that we are interested in. Again, I mentioned at the beginning that in catalysis in general, the type of materials that are studied are typically nanomaterials. So the reason is actually very simple, right? When we use nanomaterials, we take advantage of their small size. The size is being very small means that I'm increasing the number of active sites. And typically, we also want materials that are well dispersed and that have very large surface areas. Right? Again, main objective, increase the number of active sites on that material. Now, these slides, I'm showing you something that happened in 2012, and that was completely a shock to the electrocatalysis community. So these guys here, Ruben and Hu, they published a work in Angewandte Chemie that's actually demonstrated that M2C, you can see here on this slide here, molybdenum 2 carbon and MOB, these two materials are bulk materials. So you can actually, they are commercially available. What they did, they just bought those materials and test them as electrocatalysts for hydrogen production. So this curve here, this type of curve here, I will be showing this you this type of curve a lot. So it's a current density as function of over potential, as function of potential. And what is shown here, those values on the x-axis are called over potential. What that means is basically that when I'm doing the electrolysis, the ideal value of producing hydrogen, if I had the perfect catalyst, right, that overpotential will be zero. Now, because I have a lot of disturbance, the catalysis itself, the solution, the diffusion of ions, all those things leads to a loss of potential. So we call that overpotential. And that actually means the closer we are to zero, to the ideal potential, the better the catalyst will be. Now, at the time, about negative 200 in millivolt was very competitive, right? And that's the main reason why these materials are called active materials for hydrogen production, because they have a relatively low overpotential, which is close to negative 200. Now, you notice here in blue, I just mentioned here that these materials are commercially available. I'm a solid state chemist, so we care a lot about the crystal structure of materials. And in this case here, I'm showing you alpha MOB, which even as commercially available, is still contaminated by beta MOB. And I'll show you in a moment the difference in structures between these two types of materials. Now, I will not go into the details of how those, how electrocatalysis itself is basically done experimentally. So, but if you have a question about that, I can still come back and discuss about it. So now this slide here shows you the first materials that we started working with. Again, we took inspiration from the work that I just showed you, but focusing on the boron-based material part. So all compounds that I will be showing you will have boron, and we will change the metal depending on the type of compound that we are focusing on. Now, on this slide, on the right-hand side, what you are seeing is what we call the crystal structures. It's basically just atomic arrangement of atoms in 3D space. as we can see here, if you move from the top to the bottom right on top of the screen, what we see is molybdenum to boron ratio changing. On top, we have molybdenum 2 to boron. In the middle, we have those two structures I was telling you, alpha and beta, MOB. You can see that for those two structures, they have exactly the same type of structural fragment. Boron is in green, and you can see that boron will build zigzag chain, the green zigzag chain that you see there. The only difference between these two structures is that on the beta structure, we have just one direction going inside the slide. And on the alpha MOB structure, we have two boron chains that are perpendicular to each other, right? But if we are talking about catalysis is a surface phenomenon. So we are basically asking the question, what is happening on the surface of the material? How the surface is terminated in terms of this structure. So if the surface is terminated by boron, you see that there will be no difference between these two structures, alpha and beta. So they will have similar catalytic properties. Now, the last group of material here is MOB2, and I will focus a lot on this group of material. So you need to pay attention of the last structure here, which basically has boron layers, right? So if you are familiar with graphene, those boron layers are similar to the graphene layers, meaning that they have those hexagonal rings building the layer. Now, essentially what this slide is actually telling us, we are able to synthesize all these compounds. And to the left of the slide, we have what we call X-ray diffractograms. And this basically just shows us how the crystallinity of these samples is. And it shows us that we have basically large particles because we are very sharp peak. We don't have nanomaterials. This is what we wanted. And also, you can notice that we don't really have exactly single phase material, which also confirms what the commercially available alpha MOB was saying. So it's highly challenging to synthesize those phases in single phase. Now, what I'm going to show you next is basically the electrochemical performance of these four materials. As you can see on this slide here, again, that's the current density as function of the potential. And this shows us that on the left, we have boron, which is a semi-metal. Being a semi-metal, and we are conducting electrocatalysis, so we need materials that are conductive. And boron is not as conductive as molybdenum, so you expect boron not to be that active. But you can see that boron is already active compared to carbon, the carbon sheet that we see on top there, but less active than the molybdenum. Right? So in this case, we are given the potential in volt instead of millivolt. So just so you know, we've changed the unit there a little bit, but basically the same story. Now, what happened when we combine molybdenum and boron? Now you think molybdenum is more active than boron, right? And if you combine them, having more molybdenum will give you a material with the highest activity. Theoretically, yes. But if you think of the crystal structure and that the crystal structure may have an influence on these things, then you can have a surprise. And that's what actually we see. So the big surprise is that the molybdenum richest, the blue line here, the molybdenum richest compound has the lowest activity of all studied boride. And the boron richest one, MOB2, is actually the best. And you can see that alpha and beta are very close in terms of their activity. So something that the crystal structure will have predicted. Now, the question is, why is this? Why is this actually happening? Why do we see this dependency? So of the activity as function of the boron content. Now we said, okay, maybe this is unique to the molybdenum system. Let's study another system where we can see this type of variation in structure. Now this variation now starts with VB, where you have those boron chains to the left. And then if you combine those two chains with each other, we obtain what we call double chain. And we move forward to get the boron layer that I was talking to you in a moment. So VB2 is similar in structure like MOB2. Okay, so now the property also show a similar thing. So the electrochemical measurement actually shows here, like you can see, similar to molybdenum, vanadium is not that active. But once it is mixed, once we form compound with boron, we see that again here, we have the most active, the red line here is VB2. So that particular structure has something very, very interesting that I'm going to talk to you about right now. So in order to understand what is particular for that structure in terms of the activity, we studied the surface termination based on the crystal structure. Basically what we say to the top left here, if you have a molybdenum terminating the surface of the catalyst, and we have hydrogen adsorbing on top of this, we have different possibilities for that hydrogen adsorbing. On top of one atom, hollow mean between three atom sides and bridge mean between on a chemical bond, right? So we do the same thing for the boron terminated surface. The green here is boron terminated. We go even further to create different surfaces where we say we have mixed molybdenum and boron surfaces. And on top of all this, we study what we call here varying the hydrogen percentage, right? So if we take one surface, let's say we take the boron surface, which is here, bottom left. So at 25% hydrogen, what we are saying is at 25% hydrogen coverage of that surface, typically the hydrogen atoms are so far away that they will not easily make a bond between them that are close. What would happen in that case is that the hydrogen may be able to make bond with other hydrogen that are still on the solution, that are still inside the water solution. And because of that, we have less chance of producing a lot of hydrogen compared to the case here, the bottom right here, where we have 100% hydrogen. And in that case, you can see that the hydrogen atom become very close to each other. And that means when we have high current density, for example, the case close to 100% is what we actually will be getting, right? Meaning that we are adsorbing a lot of hydrogen on the surface. Now, take a look at what those calculations give us. In black, let me start with black. Black is platinum, and platinum, as I said, is the benchmark. It's the best catalyst, right? But it's expensive, and we are trying to basically replace platinum with other less expensive materials that we are studying. Now, the black curve, as you can see here, is increasing as we increase the hydrogen, as we increase the hydrogen coverage. And the most important thing for this type of calculation is that on the y-axis, we plot the diff free energy. And because we are studying adsorption-desorption process, the diff free energy for that process should be zero, right? It's just like chemical equilibrium. And at the chemical equilibrium, the deep free energy is zero. Now that means these curves here have to cross zero for we to say that we are having a good catalyst, right? So the platinum 101 surface crosses zero in free energy at about 75%. So this is one of the reasons why platinum is so active. Now, if you take a look at the MOB2 surfaces, what you will notice immediately is the green surface. Again, remember green, we are talking about the boron layer. The green plot here, you can see that it's following the platinum behavior nearly perfectly. Even more importantly, it is crossing the Gibbs free energy zero line even at higher percentages, right? Close to 85%. And what this means is that if you have materials that are terminated with this layer, they will be highly active. And this is why even in the bulk phase, not nanoscale, we already see high activity of these materials. And that means going to the nanoscale will be even more drastic in terms of improvement of the catalytic properties. So now, I will not go into the details of all those other surfaces, but what you will notice here is that every time that boron is being involved, like the pink here, mixed surface here, it typically give us a very good surface. So boron is kind of playing an important role in these materials. And this was contraintuitive because materials studied on that point were molybdenum-based, most of them. This is also why we chose molybdenum. And people actually thought that molybdenum would be the active site in all materials that are being studied. And with this work here, we show that no, that's not the case. You really need to look at the crystal structure. What is the crystal structure telling you? Right? What are the most important surfaces on the crystal structure? So our work, our contribution in this field is to let people know, okay, it's good to study materials at the nanoscale, but please come back at the crystal structure level and try to understand what's happening there. So soon after we publish our work, some other researchers published also a work on another boride, this time at the nanoscale, and they show that there also the activity is extremely high and that the boron surface is the most active surface. Now, to really prove that we can tell for sure that the boron surface is the most active one, we studied another material where that boron surface has two types of shapes, right? On the left here, we see the alpha MOB, which is MOB2, the structure I just showed you, with those flat boron layers. Close to that, we see another modification, same composition, but different structure. Now, the only difference between the two is that we have two types of boron layers here, one that's flat and another that is pocket, as you can see on the right-hand side here. Right? We call the right-hand side phosphorine-like because phosphor, the crystal structure of phosphor in terms of elemental phosphor has this type of structure here. So single phosphor layer, just like single carbon layer exists, and it has a structure similar to what you see here. Now, we studied this material theoretically first. And what we realized is that, again, here I'm plotting here the free energy as function of hydrogen coverage. What you can see on this little left-hand side is that when the layer is flat, right, you can see that the blue and red, they cross that zero line, while the pocket layer, the basically pink here, you can see that it never crosses that line. The activity here is very low. What happened with that layer is basically when hydrogen adsorbs on it, it doesn't dissolve. It makes a strong chemical bond and it stays there, right? Mm-hmm. So, and experimentally also what we did is we tried to measure not only for that phase, but for another phase where we could basically see similar structure. So replacing molybdenum by tungsten, we get a similar structure as you can see here. Now, interestingly, so the activity confirmed what theory says. So again, as you can see here, boron is not as active, molybdenum is better, but tungsten is even better, which is why we also choose tungsten there. Now you can see that beta MOB2, which has the pocket layer, is not that active compared to the alpha one. Again, even though tungsten is much active than molybdenum, as you can see here, we see that the structure wins because tungsten B2 here has an activity that's comparable to MOB2. Now, remember, these are very large particles. So the surface area doesn't play a large role here. They have all very low surface area, which is why we can do this type of comparative studies. Right. So, and this was just to prove that, okay, that boron, flat boron layer is actually key in understanding the behavior of this material. Now, because we are running out of time, I'll just show you one last case where we actually showed the importance of using the boron layer to basically understand and predict what materials will be active. Right. For on this slide, for example, I'm plotting the free energy that's being calculated, and then we study the boron surface. Now, for different materials having the same structure as the MOB2 structure, right? And what we see that we have a dependency on the type of materials. What you can see here is on the top one, on the top here, the two red are the most active, and you can basically see that we are going. The most active are right the periodic table, right? These are transition elements that we are using. The early transition metals are not so active, and the late transition metal like chromium, molybdenum, vanadium, they will predict it to be more active. We have different methods of doing this, but I'll just show you the experiment and something that also says the electronic structure that we are using is not enough. We need to check what the crystal structure says. Now, on the bottom right here, what I'm showing you is the exact same thing I showed you on the previous slide. And I want to compare this with the experiment. What we on top is what we obtain experimentally, right? So, we see also that the HER activity is increasing when we go from left to the right of the, so early transition metal is not active, and late transition metal, chromium, vanadium, molybdenum are more active. Now, you can see that the trend is not the same, right? On the experimental side, we see that titanium diboride, which is basically not so active on the bottom part, suddenly become competitive. And vanadium diboride is as active as molybdenum, right? So why is it? Why is it? We could understand this just by plotting the C over A ratio. Basically what we're saying is those structures are layered and the layer run to the C direction. So the C direction is playing a greater role than the electronic effect. So the distance between those layers is very important, which is what makes us now focus on this solid solution. Now remember, molybdenum and chromium are already active, but they have different C lattice parameters. And because they have different C lattice parameters, we can actually use that to try to understand what the effect of it will be on the activity. Now, if we make these materials called solid solution, what we see is that the A lattice parameter here follows the so-called Weigert's rule. And that rule just states that as we change one element, in this case, chromium by molybdenum, molybdenum is larger in size. So we expect that lattice parameter to be increasing because we are including more molybdenum in it. Now, if you think of the same thing for the C axis, you see that it respected until 60% molybdenum. And then at that point, it decreases drastically. So we call this canonic-like behavior of the C lattice parameter. Now, interestingly, what happened with the activity, which will be followed, this behavior or that behavior? Again, remember, we are talking about layer structure. Now, let me show you the last slide here. This is what we have just showed, the left-hand side here, that's the C lattice parameter. It is increasing and then decreasing suddenly. And on the right here in blue, I'm showing you the overpotential that we measured at 150 milliamp per square centimeter current density. We see that the behavior of that overpotential is exactly the same. And on top here is the best material. And you can see that the best material on the right-hand side, the overpotential, the current density as function of potential here, is actually even better than platinum. Platinum here is a nanoscale, and we are talking here about a bulk material being better than platinum at high current density. Now, theory already kind of hinted at this, as I showed you, that the boride, especially the boron layer, was producing hydrogen at high hydrogen coverage percentage. Experimentally, this translates to high current density. And this shows exactly what theory will be predicting for this particular material. Now, I know I'm done here, so we will not focus that much on the nanomaterials. I said the synthesis of these materials is really challenging. So 3 years ago, we discovered a method to produce them at 900 degrees C. All other materials that I've shown you until now are produced at 3000 degrees C using a method called arc melting. So these materials are extremely stable. At the same time, they are very challenging to synthesize at low temperatures. By low temperature, we mean close to 1000 degrees C. Now, I will not show you most of those results, but the power of the nanoscale here is that we can now study different morphology. For the same material that we can see here, MoB2, we can make spherical-like particles and rod-like particles. And you can see that the activity of these two types of materials is completely different. Right? That's the power of the nanoscale. So I know I'm a little bit of the time here, but thank you for listening.